Hey everyone, my name is Wael, and today we'll be talking about link manipulation. Now imagine that you receive an email with a catchy link from a website that you trust and you visited before. Only when you click it or copy and paste it to your browser, you end up at a completely different destination. Welcome to the hidden world of link manipulation. So we're going to be splitting this into five difficulty levels of link manipulation. Level 1 and 2 are for beginners and inexperienced users. Level 3, 4, and 5 are going to be interesting even for those who are well experienced with link manipulation techniques. So let's start with the basics. Here's an example link or URL that you might want to visit. The first part is the scheme, which is typically HTTPS or HTTP. Nowadays, every browser will warn you if you try to visit an HTTP-only website, simply because the traffic between you and the website is unencrypted, meaning that somebody sitting between you and the website can view everything in raw text. The next part is the subdomain, which in this example, it's testing. Now, this can be more than one subdomains or more than one levels of subdomains. So it could be a.b.c.testing. The rest of the things after example.com, so the forward slash and whatever else after that, is not something that we're really interested in, because typically that's just some kind of like an instruction to the website that you're visiting to give you the right content or the exact page under that website that you want. What we really care about most of the cases is example.com, which is example in our case is the domain, and .com, which is the TLD or top level domain. Example.com could be owned by a completely different person or company than example.net or example.org. So we should always pay attention that we're actually on the correct website, the correct domain, and the correct TLD. In some cases that we're going to see later, we actually care about the subdomain too, but let's start with the examples. Let's start with the simple link manipulation techniques that we see. We have here a good link of microsoft.com/something cool. We don't really care about this part, as we said before, because it's just an instruction to the website. Now, a typical method that attackers will use is that they will use a domain, which is in this case xx.is, which, as weird as it sounds, it's actually a domain that you can buy. But they have a subdomain which they control, which is called Microsoft. So to the eye at a quick look, you can say, oh, I'm visiting Microsoft, but it's not Microsoft. It's actually taking you to xx.is, or at least something controlled by the owner of that domain. Now, another thing that they use is typos or characters that look similar, but they're not the same. In this example, we can see Microsoft with one normal O and then with a zero instead of an O, which is basically a different domain controlled by a different person, which could be malicious. Probably it is malicious. We can see the same with less obvious typos, which could be Microsoft with two S here, with two S's. So Microsoft.com instead of Microsoft.com, again, owned by a completely different person that could be malicious. And then we can see a combination, or at least like, you know, a more advanced example of this one here, which could be microsoft.com.xx.is, which is again controlled, it's multi-level subdomain controlled again by the person owning xx.is. Now let's go and take a look at our sample email here. We can see that this here, you can see it's taking us to microsoft.com.xx.is, and this is the actual link to Microsoft. So if you click on that, we'll actually get to this URL here. Now let's take a look at this example here of level 2 manipulation techniques. Now this is rarely seen by itself. Usually it's combined with other methods that we're going to see next, but it's worth mentioning nevertheless. So every website that you're visiting or interacting with eventually has or gets translated into an IP address. Now think of it this way. If somebody wants to visit you, you will give them a location, XYZ street at Z city in O country. So they know that you live at that specific address. The same goes with websites. When you're trying to visit the website, there is an intermediary service which basically takes the link that you sent to it and translates it into the actual location where the server lives that's actually serving you the content. In this example here, we see the IP address represented in its normal format, or at least the IPv4 address, which has been here for a long, long time. And it used to be the standard until now. Here is just a hexadecimal representation. Now, we're not going to go deep into what each representation means, but basically, this IP address can be seen in this format, and this format, and this format, and they all lead to the same exact address. Now, there is a new version of IP addresses, which is called IPv6, which to actually visit it in the browser, you will have to see it in brackets. So if we go here, we have level 2. If we click on this link, it's going to take us to this website, which is the Internet Signed Numbers Authority, just a random website with a direct IP address link. If we go to the other examples as well, we can see this example here takes us to the same website. Now, we've talked about domains and top-level domains and how they can be used, but let's take a look at less obvious examples where the top-level domain is the one that we're relying on to trick users, or this is what the attacker will do. So we have docs.google.com, which is the actual Google Docs website, but then we have the availability to purchase docs.tech as a malicious actor. So we can actually send you a link with docs.tech or docs.google.tech. You think that you're actually visiting Google Docs, but you're actually visiting something controlled by an attacker. Now, another top-level domain, which is going to be really dangerous once it's available, is .docs. So imagine that you own, or the bad actor owns, google.docs. This is going to be really tricky for users to distinguish between google.docs, which can be owned by a malicious actor, hopefully not, or docs.google.com. But let's see something a little bit more tricky. So we've said at the first part of the video that we don't really care about the subdomains, but in this case, we actually care. Because Cloudflare and Azure Front and other websites, they allow you to host your website under their domain and top-level domain. In this example, Cloudflare gives you pages.dev, and then Azure Front or Azure Front Door gives you this .azurefd.net. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at what they look like. So if we click at microsoft login.pages.dev, we're actually taken to a completely different thing than Microsoft. Now let's take a look at something a little bit more advanced. So if you're visiting a website, if you see the at symbol after the domain and the top-level domain or whatever you have here, you're not actually visiting amazon.com. You're actually visiting evil.com in this example. And this can be combined with characters, which is another technique used, characters that look similar, but they're not the same. So here you can see the two forward slashes, which are completely different characters. So this forward slash is the typical one that you see in links, which leads to docs.google.com, a Google document that they actually have. But here in this example, we have this slightly twisted forward slash, which is a completely different character that looks the same to the eye, but it's actually ignored. So all this part here until the at is ignored. This is like, we're not going to go deep into why this happens, but xx.is is the actual domain that we're visiting. And we can add some query parameters, like random strings at the end, to make it less obvious. So if you purchase like a domain this short, it's really easy for the user to skip this part and think they're actually going to visit a Google document. Now, this example becomes really tricky with .zip domains. So .zip top-level domains are a new thing that nobody asked for, but Google somehow thought that it's a good idea. But the danger here is that you have this GitHub link, which is for a zip file, and you have here a combination of the previous techniques that we mentioned with the twisted forward slash, but then you have the at v1.27.1.zip. This link will actually take you to 1.zip. This is the domain, because right now you can actually register a .zip domain. Now, I did not purchase one .zip because it's too expensive, but you can have anything .zip, which is really dangerous. And you can have this technique combined with the IP address manipulation technique that we mentioned before. So this is an IP address. Again, github.com with the forward slashes. And then at the end, we have @ and the IP address. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the examples in an email to see how tricky they can be. So if we go here to level 4, we can see that we have this URL here, which is legit Google document, or it should be. It's kind of broken, but still under google.com. And here we have another one, which is using the twisted, slightly twisted forward slashes with the @, and then my domain, which is really short, .is, which is not exactly owned by Google. So if we click on this, we actually get this virus detected thing. Luckily, this is owned by me, so we know it's not that dangerous. But the interesting thing is that even if you copy the link or you click copy that address, you can actually see that the browser is warning you. It's trying to tell you without any obvious warning that this is not google.com. But here you can see the URL, and if we click go, we actually get the virus detected again. Now let's take a look at the less obvious examples. Here we have the .zip domain, which is again with the forward slashes and the @ symbol. If we click on that, we end up at .zip. Now it's not gonna load because it's not owned by anyone right now, or nobody's like, you know, doing anything with it. And here we have this one with the IP address. So if we click on this, we should actually land on the website that we've seen in the previous steps. Now you probably know about short URLs. Short URLs, if you don't know, are somehow like, you know, shortened versions of URLs that you can create that will redirect the user to a website of your choice. You can go to services like Bitly or tinyurl, and you can create that link. Now, for the sake of this example, I've created a simple non-malicious URL here, which is bit.ly/ytwm. If we go to that, we're taken to the channel, to the YouTube channel. Now, if we run this through a service like where goes or unshorten it or redirect checker, basically we call them unshortening services, we can actually see the end URL that we're going to be visiting. But if we combine short URLs with a few tricks that we've seen before, plus some JavaScript code, we can actually fool even the unshortening services that we've seen. So let's go to our examples. We have this example here, a random short URL. If we go to where it goes, it says that it takes us to 000.pages.dev. Let's try another service just to be sure that we're not fooling only one. Same thing. Here's the thing though. If we actually click on that link, we're taken indeed to that page, but then we're redirected to linkedin.com in this case. So an attacker can actually take it even a step further. They can take a short URL that redirects us to something that looks legit. So in this example, again, one of the tricks that we've learned before about URL obfuscation, we can see here, notice the @ and then the different domain and TLD that's being taken. So if we go ahead and click on the link, notice here, so we're taken to the different domain and then we're forwarded to linkedin.com. Again, this is just another example of combining different techniques together. Now we might have not covered every technique possible. There are some other techniques that either work or not work well nowadays with modern browsers, but you get the point. Links cannot be trusted, or at least not blindly. You should still use unshortening services with short URLs. I'm not saying you shouldn't, but even using them does not mean that you're absolutely safe. You have to be careful at what you're seeing actually as a user. So the moral of the story is that you need to be extra careful whenever you click on a link or whenever you copy and paste a link. Even if you use unshortening services or other similar tools, you still have to keep your eyes open and look for tricks that we've seen in the previous parts of the video to stay safe and avoid clicking on the wrong link and paying heavily for that. If you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe to the channel, and share it with others to spread the knowledge. If you have any questions, feel free to drop them in the comments below. Otherwise, see you next time.